I'm no soldering expert, but I have made and remade a number of pieces of copper distillation equipment, and here I share a few techniques I have found useful. Soldering copper is easy. It's easy to clean with abrasives such as emery paper or wire wool. The solder readily fills narrow spaces by capillary action. The process is fairly forgiving for both poor cleaning and uneven flux application because, like the solder, the flux is drawn by capillary action into joints. When assembling small components like this, I tend not to use copper pipe fittings, partly because they're expensive and partly because they take up quite a lot of space. Instead, I use copper pipe that's been cut down the side and flattened out to form a sheet, then cut discs out of that copper. Alternatively, if working with pipe diameter that fits readily available copper coins, I use one. The United Kingdom Mint is particularly thoughtful about this because their 1 penny coin fits perfectly inside 22 mm copper pipe, and their 2 penny coin fits 28 mm copper pipe. Joints are made by resting one copper component onto the sheet and then heating and adding the solder. A problem with that is that it's very easy to inadvertently move the piece resting on the sheet by touching it with the solder wire. A better method is to cut a small piece off the solder wire and place it on the joint held there by the flux. Here I am moving the solder next to the inside of the joint. Then heat the joint, and when it's hot, the solder melts and runs all the way round. This method also helps keep the amount of solder used to a minimum and makes the joints neater. Once this joint is made, you can use tin snips or files to remove the excess sheet copper. Quite often you'll want to solder a pipe to a plain sheet, such as here. This is fairly easy to do using a twist drill to make the hole up to a diameter of about 8 mm. Above that, twist drills drilling sheet material tend to make triangular shaped holes like this, which will not fit the pipe well enough to solder. My solution here is to clamp the copper sheet to a piece of wood, which has the right diameter hole drilled into it and can act as a jig. If the hole position isn't critical, then you can just drill through both together as here. For holes of diameter 15 mm or more, you'll probably be using a hole saw or some form of adjustable rotating scribe like this. These do not make quite such neat holes as twist drills. For solder to be drawn into a joint by capillary action, the joint gap should not be more than about a quarter of a millimetre. At 28 or 35 millimetres or more, it can be quite hard to achieve a hole that's that precise. The solution here is a wire ring like this. You form a piece of solid copper wire into a ring that tightly fits around the pipe to be soldered. Then, after a bit of squeezing and manipulation and trimming to length, you arrange it so it fits snugly in the corner between the pipe and the sheet. That gives much more area for solder to flow into, making the joint stronger and more tolerant of imperfect gaps. To solder two pipes together to make a T junction, you can drill a hole of the right size in the tube that will form the top of the T. That works okay if the T top tube is larger than the T stem, but it doesn't work if they are similar in size or if the top is smaller. In that case, it's easier to shape the end of the T stem pipe to fit the top with a round file like this, then solder them together, and only then use a drill that fits the inside of the T stem pipe to drill through the T top pipe wall. When you've got a piece like this, which is the bottom end of my stripping column, there are multiple soldered joints on a small piece of copper. That means that when you heat the copper to do one joint, the whole thing's going to get hot and all the other joints are going to melt. If it's not held properly, then they're going to fall apart, particularly butt joints. I've made a lot of things like this. This was my first attempt at a digital parrot, and you can see that it contains 10 joints. It's just not feasible to rig up a jig that holds everything together and then heat it to make all the joints at once. It's much easier to make one joint at a time. That leads to the problem of holding the previous joints together while the next ones are made. I tried various ways of doing this, but the solution I eventually settled on was a combination of using small pieces of solder rather than direct wire contact and damp sand. It's damp not for cooling, but so that it clings together better. You simply make the first joint, then put the piece to be soldered in the sand, exposing the next part of it to be soldered. Then you assemble the next joint, flux it, and add a piece of solder. Then heat it and even if the whole component gets hot and the solder in the other joints melts, the sand will hold them all in place, so that when it cools and the solder resets, they will all be sound. This is an easy technique that's not demanding of skill and that can be done with inexpensive equipment and materials. Most of the copper I use is recycled domestic water or gas pipe, but the largest diameter you are likely to find in that context is 28 millimeters. That's why my first columns were 28 millimeters in diameter. To buy new copper is getting expensive. Copper has the advantage of leaching out bad tasting sulfates from the product, but you don't have to make the still out of copper to achieve that. The main competing material for still manufacture is stainless steel, which is a lot cheaper. Copper is easier to work with simple hand tools, whereas stainless steel requires considerably more skill and equipment. It's difficult to form, and joining it usually involves TIG welding. At the moment, I would say copper is more cost effective up to a pipe diameter of around 35 millimeters. Beyond that, the price goes up sharply. So for 3 or 4 inch and possibly even 2 inch columns, stainless steel is cheaper by a margin such that even on quite modest projects, the cost of the stainless steel and the equipment to work with it would be less than the cost of copper alone.